Hello, welcome back to the presentation on the mechanics of materials. This is an initiative by PTU eShikshana program. So we are studying the module 4. Under that, we have covered already theories of failure. Today, we are going to cover the torsion chapter in module 4. Now, the prescribed syllabus in this chapter is the circular solid and hollow shafts, torsional movement of resistance, power transmission in stepped and straight shafts, twist in shaft sections, thin tubular sections, and thin wall sections. So here you can see the number of shafts in this photograph. You can see different types of shafts. These are solid circular shafts, and this is solid, this is hollow circular shaft, and you can see a stepped shaft here. Now these shafts are mainly used in power transmission, to transmit the power between the motor and machines, or motor and pumps, and in automobile engines for power transmission from the engine to the rear wheels. So during all these applications, the shafts are normally subjected to a torsional movement or twisting movement. So we need to design the shaft based on this torsional movement. So you can see the solid shaft having a single diameter D and hollow shaft internal diameter and external diameters. The objectives of this study are to calculate the shear stresses that are developed in the shafts due to the torsional load, and to derive and apply the torsional equation to find the diameter of the shaft. Basically, design of shaft involves finding the diameter of the shaft, and also to understand the behavior of shaft under the application of torsion load, and also to compare the torsional strengths of the solid and hollow cylinders. Now, coming to the torsion in circular shafts, you can see that many engineering applications utilize the operation of a shaft, and these shafts are normally subjected to torsional loads. So what is this torsional force or twisting force? You can see that when an object is twisted from one end, and when the other end is held in position, it is called as a twisted movement. It is subjected to twisted movement. You can see the two examples here. In this case, the shaft is subjected to the twisting movement in opposite directions. And in other case, which is a non-circular shaft, also subjected to twisting movement in opposite directions. But in most of the applications, the preferred section is circular section, as it is efficient in resisting the torsional loads. Now, before going into much details, let us see what is torque. Torque is the movement of force, or simply a movement which denotes the force required to rotate an object about a fixed axis, which may be a pivot or a fulcrum. Now, this force is, what is force? Force is nothing but pushing and pulling of an object. You can see here in the sketch, a screwdriver drives the screw into the wooden block. So to do so, you need to apply a torque by using the screwdriver. So in this case, the force is expended in turning the object is said to be under the action of torque. Now, why this torque is important? Because see, when torque is applied, you can determine the magnitude and rotational force applied on the object. And also it helps in analyzing the results that may be generated due to the application of the torque. Torque helps us to determine whether the force is applied in a clockwise or counterclockwise direction. And also torque can help us to predict the angular acceleration to which the object is subjected. The torque depends on different factors like the magnitude of the force, the distance between the point of application of force and the rotation axis, the orientation of force with reference to the displacement from the point of application of the force. And the torque is given by the equation, or it is denoted by Newton meters, where Newton indicates the force and M is the distance in meters, okay? Now, circular shafts are commonly used to transmit power in rotating machinery. Hence, you need to design the shaft to withstand the torsion to avoid the failure of shaft during its service life. Now, the different materials exhibit in a different way they respond in a different way to the application of the torsional load. Some materials may deform, change in dimension, or some may show cracks, and some part may even break depending on the type of material and the magnitude of the torsional load applied. So I can see a diagram where the failure has been taken place, the part has been cut into two pieces, and you can see the lines here, these radial lines have been straight initially, and once when it is failed due to twisting, the radial lines have been twisted, changed in their position. What do you mean by pure torsion? Now, a pure torsion is a condition when the shaft is subjected to only the torque, okay, or torsion without being acted by any other load, that is bending moment or any other axial force. Such conditions or such cases rarely exist, but for the case of deriving the equations, we assume that the shaft is under pure torsion, that is, it is subjected to only a torque or a twisting moment. So now, or we can say that if shaft is subjected to two opposite turning moments, it is said to be in pure torsion, only turning moments. Okay. So if material is subject to twisting by the application of a couple, normally shear stresses are induced in the material. Okay. So this is another definition for pure torsion. If a couple is applied to cylindrical rod such a way that the axis of the couple is coincident with the axis of the rod, then the rod is said to be subjected to a pure torsion, or a pure torsion condition prevails. Now, coming to some of the assumptions made in the theory of pure torsion. So these are required for deriving the equations. You can see on the right hand side the diagram. Before the application of torsion, you can see the radial lines are straight, and when the torque is applied in counterclockwise direction, you can see that these radial lines have been shifted or twisted from their original position, but there is no change in the dimension of the object. Now, some assumptions made here are the material of the shaft used is having homogeneous and isotropic properties. The properties in all directions are same, and throughout it exhibits the same properties. The cross section of the shaft remains same before and after the twist. Then the shear stress is proportional to shear strain. That means the material obeys the Hooke's law. It is well under the elastic limit. Twist along the whole length of the shaft remains uniform, and circular sections remain circular with radii remaining straight after twist also. So now, during the deformation, the cross sections are not distorted in any manner. You can see here they remain plain, and the radius r does not change. In addition, the length l of the shaft also remains constant. L remains constant, and the radius also will not change. So these are some of the assumptions made in the theory of pure torsion, and these are taken in derivation of the torsion equation. Generally, there are two types of stresses induced in a shaft: torsional shear stress due to the during the transmission of torque, then the bending stresses due to the weight of the pulley, gear, etc., that are mounted on the shaft. So now, what are these two? Torsional stress is nothing but the shear stress produced in the shaft due to the application of twisting moment. And this is caused by the couple acting on it. Couple is set up by the forces, pair of forces acting in opposite directions. And the bending stress is normal stress induced at a point which may cause the component to bend. When load is applied perpendicular to the length of the beam, the bending moments are also induced in the beam. Now you can see the torsional equation here. It's very important. T by J is equal to tau by R is equal to G theta by L is the torsional equation. which the derivation of which we'll see later. Now, where T is the torque applied on the shaft, you can see here in the diagram, this is the shaft. And the torque applied at the ends in acting in the opposite directions. And this is the length of the shaft. And this is angle theta through which the line distortion has taken place. So now you can see that T is the torque applied, J is polar moment of inertia in millimeter fourth. So what is this? We'll study in the definitions. Then the maximum shear stress induced at the outermost fiber surface. R is the radius of the shaft. G is the modulus of rigidity. Theta is angle of twist, normally expressed in radians, and length of the shaft in millimeters. Now, coming to the polar moment of inertia, what is this polar moment of inertia? It represents actually a resistance to the twisting movement or twisting deformation in the shaft. It is expressed in millimeter to the power 4. Now, the equation for this is pi d 4th by 32 for a solid shaft, and for hollow shaft, it is pi into capital D to the power 4 minus small d to the power 4 divided by 32, which is a hollow shaft, where capital D is the outside diameter and small d is the inside diameter of the shaft. So these two equations are used to find the polar moment of inertia of a shaft. Now, shear modulus or modulus of rigidity is similar to the Young's modulus, which is defined as the ratio of shear stress to the shear strain expressed in MPa or GP. And then angle of twist is the angle through which the twisting has taken place. That is, the torque deformation of a shaft tube is measured by the twist angle at the end of the shaft. Now, this angle of twist normally depends on the length of the shaft, the angle of shift, twist, and it is used in general torsion equation for estimating the shear strain. Then, coming to the polar section modulus, it is the ratio of polar moment of inertia to the radius measured from the center of the center to outermost fiber. So we can see here, the equation changes according to whether it is solid shaft or hollow shaft. In case of solid shaft, now polar section modulus represented by Z is equal to J by R, polar moment of inertia by radius. So for solid shaft, pi d 4th by 32 by radius d by 2, which is pi d cube by 60. Similarly, for hollow shaft, Z is equal to J by R. Now the equation, you can see there is a change in equation of J, pi into d 4th minus d 4th by 32 by d by 2. So where D, capital D and small d are the outside and inside diameters. There is another term that is torsional rigidity, which represents the ratio of torque to the angle of twist. It is the torque required to produce an unit angle of twist in an unit length of the shaft. So it is also called as torsional stiffness. So normally torsional rigidity of the hollow shaft is found to be greater than that of solid shaft. Also, there is another designation that is torsional strength, which is the ratio of torsional movement to the shear stress. It is a ratio of torque per unit maximum shear stress. And finally, we have torsional flexibility, which is the ratio, it is the reciprocal of torsional rigidity, which is given by theta by T, which is the ratio of angle of twist per unit torque. Now, one important equation that is used to find the power transmitted by shaft is, that is P is equal to 2 pi nt by 60,000 kilowatts. Now, this is obtained from taking the power. Power is equal to work done per second, that is mean torque into, this work done is given by torque into the angle turned by the shaft per second. So that gives you torque into angle turned per second is 2 pi n by 60. So this equation becomes P is equal to 2 pi nt by 60,000, which is expressed in kilowatts, where T can be taken as the mean torque in Newton meters and n is the speed in RPM. Now, how the shaft how the shear stress is distributed in the shaft. We can see in the diagram the shear stress distribution in shafts. So you can see that in case of solid shaft, there is a linear variation between the radius and the distance, and the shear stress as a distance from the innermost fiber to the outermost fiber. You can see that the shear stress linearly increases and reaches the maximum value at the outermost fiber. And in case of hollow shaft, you can see that since this portion is hollow, the shear stress will start from here and end up with the maximum stress, which is much, much lesser than in case of solid shaft. You can see that. So that is why normally in many applications, the hollow shafts are preferred to the solid shaft. Okay. So in case of solid circular shaft, maximum shear stress is induced at the outer surface and zero shear stress at the center at maximum load also. This is the variation of shear stress or shear stress distribution in circular, solid and hollow shafts. Now, if we consider the design of the shafts, it can be designed based on strength and rigidity criteria. So that is, to find the diameter, we use two criteria. First, we take strength criteria, where in the torsion equation, that is T by J is equal to tau by R is equal to G theta by L, we take the first portion of the equation, that is T by J is equal to tau by R, interchanging the terms, T by tau is equal to J by R, which is nothing but Z, or T is equal to tau into Z. Okay. So in this equation, if I substitute the value of the shear stress, then that is pi by 16 D cube, I can find the diameter of the shaft. Okay. The value of Z, if I substitute, we know that section modulus Z is equal to pi by 16 D cube. If I substitute here, I can find the diameter of the shaft. By knowing the shear stress of the material and torque, we can find the diameter. We can design the diameter of the shaft. Similarly, in case of hollow shaft, only the equation changes for the hollow shaft. So as the value of Z changes, so you can design or you can find the diameter of the shaft based on the strength criteria. So this is based on strength criteria for solid and hollow shafts. Rigidity criteria, we take the second part of the equation and we'll design the diameter of the shaft. Now, coming to the thin tubular sections, you can see that in the diagrams, you can see thin tubular sections, you can see pipes which are used in many applications of transmission of power. So you can see that the circular hollow sections exist in different cross sections, circular, square, rectangular sections. And you can see another diagram here, square section, circular section. So thin walled steel circular hollow sections are widely used in wind turbine towers. They are available in various cross sections. And the last is thin walled sections. You can see different cross sections, a thin strip, rectangular in shape, circular shape, which is O-ring, then C channel, L section, and Z section. So the cross section of thin walled beams is made from thin panels connected to create the closed or open cross sections. Okay, the typical sections include round, square, rectangular, tubes. Then open sections include I-beams, T-beams, and L-beams. Thank you.